Well, good morning, you children of snakes. I love the NRSV version. It says, oh, you brood of vipers. If there was ever a more exciting text in the Holy Scriptures, it is this one. Good morning and welcome to Joy Sunday here at Vista Ridge United Methodist Church. We pray that this Sunday finds you and your brood doing well. This is a gift. This Advent text is a gift in the lectionary for this week. It's set apart to celebrate the expectation of joy as we await the promised coming of the Christ child. But upon first glance, this text is a far cry from a nice reading of, say, 'Twas the Night Before Christmas, like my father used to do to prepare me for what was to come on the 25th. This story seems like a very strange Advent text until you meditate on what John the Baptizer is truly saying. In Luke's third chapter, we come upon this group gathered in the wilderness. So they've left the hustle and bustle of the city and of their jobs and maybe even their families, unless they've brought them along, and they've wandered out into the wilderness to find this man. This crazy man who eats locusts and covers himself in animal skins and preaches about crazy things that are coming. Now, I don't know about you, but if this is written in a Facebook invitation, I am definitely marking only maybe. But this crowd just seems to keep getting larger and larger. Something's happening here. So it begs us to dig deeper. So let's rejoin the text in chapter 3 at the end of verse 7. Oh, you children of snakes, who warned you to escape the angry judgment that is coming? Produce fruit that shows you have changed your hearts and lives. And don't even think about saying to yourselves, Abraham is our father. I tell you, God is able to raise up Abraham's children from these stones. The axe is already at the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that doesn't produce good fruit will be chopped down and tossed into the fire. Now, I appreciate John. John ain't got no time for chit-chat. John has a message to tell the people, and he doesn't want to tell it twice. So I imagine he's either standing in the water, or at least near the bank of the river, and he is yelling at the people. You brood of vipers. He's yelling at them, telling them, pay attention. And I love how he stops them and says, and don't even think about coming down here and telling me who you are. That who you are is what makes you deserving of this message of salvation. You see, that's the first truth of the gospel, isn't it? That it doesn't matter who you are. It has nothing to do with your status or your race, your gender or nationality. It has nothing to do with the family tree from which you've come. The gospel message is for all people. Where Paul and the early church will continue this message, it's not just for the Jews, but for the Gentiles too. John the Baptizer is foretelling of this new way to connect to God's kingdom. And he even says that, in fact, the axe already sits at the root of the tree. Now, this is an image of sort of your family tree being that which connects you to your status and your worth in the world. And John saying the axe already sits there. In fact, this message of this new kingdom may cut some of us off from that root from which we came. I think earlier in my faith, I may have read that differently. But after the last 5 years, it's become painfully true. Sometimes this call to live a different kind of life cuts us off in relationship from some of those that we love dearest. John reminds us that the good news has nothing to do with who we are and has everything to do with who we are. Now, this is a radical message for the crowd gathered. And they begin asking John, What must we do to join this movement, this new way, this covenantal relationship with God and creation? You have to remember, up until this point, places were talking about great sacrifices that would have to be made at the altar and at the door to join in to the people of God. Sometimes those sacrifices came in things you brought, and sometimes they came in ways in which your body was included in the sacrifice. So we pick up in verse 10, the crowds asked him, "What then should we do?" And he answers this, "Whoever has two shirts must share with the one who has none, and whoever has food must do the same." Now, thinking that generosity may be enough for the average person, but the tax collectors that were present, of course, we know the famous stories of the tax collectors in the scripture. These are the people you did not want coming to your door. This is not Amazon. These people were there to take from you. They thought maybe it was enough for a good and moral person to just give freely, but for them, what would they need to do to be included in this kingdom coming? And John replies this, "Collect no more than you are authorized to collect," in verse 13. Seems really simple. And so the soldiers who are there, they say, "Well, what about us? What should we do?" Of course, again, thinking that integrity and generosity may be enough for the average moral person to belong to this new kingdom, but they've lived harsh lives. They've raped and pillaged and stolen and killed for someone else's kingdom. So what must they do to be worthy of entrance into this new covenant? And so John replies this, "Don't cheat or harass anyone, and be satisfied with your pay." You see, this good news message has nothing to do not just with who you are as according to your family tree, but who you've been. It has nothing to do with what you did before you got to this good place. This good news has everything to do with the fruit which you bear after hearing it. Live and work with generosity, integrity, compassion, and gratitude. There's this story of a young boy. He was born probably around the 3rd century in what's known today as modern Turkey. He's born to very, very wealthy parents. He's well-to-do and has a powerful last name. That means he's in a status above many, many others. But one of the things that was different about his upbringing is that he was told this good news story about this new kingdom and this new way of living. Sadly, he goes through something that we know all too well. There's an epidemic throughout the world in the 3rd century, and he loses both of his parents to the illness. So then he's stuck with a choice. He's an orphan. He can use his wealth and his status to become someone, or he can heed what his parents taught him, this different way of life. And he does just that. There are stories and stories told of his generosity, of paying the debt of those who could not get out of poverty or out of shackles and bonds. He pays the dowry of girls within his community who could not be married or become anything else in society without him. Some of the more fantastical stories are of little sacks of coins thrown by him through windows and chimneys at night that landed in stockings hung by the fire to dry. If it sounds familiar, it's the story of Saint Nicholas, who we sort of hold up and recognize and celebrate during this season. You see, Nicholas understood the gospel. He understood that his family roots were not as important as his rootedness in Christ. And yet, if the scripture today ends with verse 14, and we get this sort of beat down from John the Baptizer about being better people, and this great story about Saint Nick doing just that, but knowing that we will never fill the shoes of the man in red, then we leave here without a lot of joy. or even the truth. You see, verse 15 is the craziest part of this whole story. Without verse 15, this story is just about a crazy man who dreams of a better world. Without verse 15, John could have very well incited a revolt in the wilderness because he has just called them all broods of vipers and stomped on their very character. But verse 15 tells us something different is happening here. The people were filled with expectation. And everyone wondered whether John might just be the Christ, the Messiah, the one who would save them. You see, Luke does not explain why the crowds have come out to be baptized by John in the wilderness. But across the biblical narrative, the wilderness is often a place where human need meets and encounters God's gracious provision. Whatever their reasons, this crowd leaves their relative comfort of home and ventures into the wilderness to be baptized by this prophet. And verse 15 tells us that this good news isn't about moral character. It's not just about being people of integrity or generosity. It's about salvation. It's not just about becoming better people. It's about joining John the Baptizer in ushering in a new kingdom. It's about what I was talking about last week, about being crazy. If John the Baptizer was anything, he was crazy. He believes so passionately that another world is coming, that he is literally splashing people in the face to wake up to it already being here, to come alive with the holy purpose within them. And they are. The scripture says that they are filled with expectation. We hear over and over that the Advent season is one of expectation. Mary is expecting. We are expecting. My four-year-old is trying every ounce of her patience and mine, waiting for what's to come. But what are we waiting for? We are waiting for the fully realized kingdom of Jesus to come on earth as it is in heaven. The new covenant that was foretold by John the Baptizer when he prophesied of the one to come who would baptize not just by water, but of fire and the Spirit. The one Jesus foretold as he broke the bread and ushered in this new covenant with us. This covenant where family trees don't matter, your job doesn't matter. What you've done before this moment and who you've been doesn't matter. What matters is that you show up, that you spurn towards true love, the true love that gives your shirt for another. This covenant that breaks the chains of a world trying to drain our imagination and our curiosity and our wonder. A covenant that frees us for joyful obedience in the co-creation of the new kingdom, where the rule is love and the politic is justice and mercy. My church, I cannot think of anything more mystical and wonderful and magical and joyful than that truth. So this morning, as we prepare to walk to the table, as we prepare to receive this message in tangible resource, this goodness of grace and forgiveness, let us pray. Oh, mighty God, we give you thanks. Remind us once again that this season is not just about gifts. It's not just about family. It's not even about generosity outside of yours towards us. But that the season is a spark, it's a fire, It's your purpose in the world to bring about this new kingdom where things are different, where there are crazy people who eat bugs and talk about loving one another and doing life with a deeper compassion. God, we still get trapped in this world that tells us it's about everything else. May your light of this season guide our path of remembrance. Remembrance of the act which you provided for us. This gateway into breaking bread with you at this massive table where there is a seat for all. Today, remind us the truth of the Advent season, that it's all about the joy of your kingdom coming on earth as it is in heaven. And that is what we pray. Amen. We are going to enter